Okay, can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay. First of all, thank you very much for that presentation. I mean, I didn't really expect a video slideshow of my profile there, but it's very creative, I must say. Yeah, thank you very much. Okay. So, there is something which something that goes very unnoticed or is very less talked about when it comes to photography or videography. You said that students are from electronic media and
mass communication.
So how many of you are from electronic media here and mass communication? So it's more or less equal numbers here. Okay. So if I ask you all what is democracy? What would anybody tell roughly what is democracy? What do you mean by democracy? By the people, for the people. Okay, something about equality, everybody having access to things. So there is one tool which is today the most democratic tool, that is camera. Because everybody has an access to camera. I'm a photographer, but I'm not carrying my heavy equipment, but I have a camera here in the phone. So when I say that camera is the most democratic tool and photography is democratic craft, it means that once upon a time, there was a lot of monopoly in visual communication, in photography. Very few people had access to tell stories about their lives, about the communities they live in, and the world around them. So today, it's become democratic. So everybody is in a position to tell stories. Even if you're not doing electronic media or visual communication studies, you still can go ahead and publish your own stories where, if not newspapers, online, Facebook, Instagram, even selfies or stories sometimes. So with that, we proceed to something. I mean, I prepared a very customized lecture because I'm not going to talk much about camera, actually very little about camera, but I'm going to talk about two things which I think is a prerequisite to be doing anything in visual communication, whether it's art or whether mass communication, whether you're going to be a journalist or something in your daily life. It's something which is a must now. It's a prerequisite. Next. Have you ever heard of this term, or have you ever, you know, used it in your curriculum? No? Okay. As expected, as visual literacy. Okay, what's the first thing you do when you're born?
Cry.
Cry? Really? Or do you like, you're born, you're speaking, hi dad, hi mom? No. Are you gonna speak in a foreign language? No. Hola, senorita, nothing like that, right? Are you gonna get up and dance?
No.
Cry? Yeah, but before crying, there's something else that you do.
Open your eyes.
Open your eyes. Yes. The first thing that you do when you come to this world, open your eyes. First thing you do is see. You learn to see, right? And even before we start learning a visual, spoken language, before we build up a vocabulary, by the time you're one or two, as babies, we learn to recognize faces and things. A baby sees its parent, recognizes, and is very comfortable. Probably the baby sees a very bearded photographer and scared and starts running away, crawling away. So we, as human beings, we tend to recognize things first before we start speaking. But because of that, there is a strange situation. Please make a note of this John Berger Ways of Seeing. It's actually a documentary made in 1972, and it has relevance even today and beyond. Okay, so when John Berger made his documentary, when he brought about this point, the sight comes before words, We learn to see before we learn to talk. So it's not really my original quote, it belongs to John Berger and his contemporaries. So, so since sight is natural, we have disregarded that learning to see, learning to interpret the world is something which doesn't need any formal training. And we spend rest of our lives, our academic curriculum in our elementary education, everything is built around learning to count, learning to do the math, learning three different languages, learning about the geographies, political science, everything. But learning to see and interpret things is something which is never spoken about, right? And so much of the visual communication that happens today is left to intuition. I mean, we probably learn more about cameras, we probably learn more about equipments, editing, Photoshop, everything, but not much of emphasis goes in seeing the world and interpreting and making a meaning out of it. So today, what I'm going to talk about are two things. One is just an introduction to what visual literacy is and why it is important, and you probably can take a lead and pursue visual literacy as a subject in future, probably for higher studies and or for your own good. You know, it is a must. And the second thing I'm going to talk about is something photographic composition, called as the language of the image. Because you've been studying all your life about building a vocabulary to speak and write, I'm just going to introduce you a small vocabulary in making images as a photographer, as a videographer, as a producer, as a director. At the same time, to interpret images as a consumer, as an audience, as a viewer, I'm going to touch about two things. So the first part of visual literacy is going to be a small introduction, because it is a big topic, and the video you guys made, you mentioned about my school where I did photojournalism scholarship diploma, the Ateneo de Manila University. They actually have certificate programs in visual literacy, up post your graduation or anything. If you want to take up those subjects, you can probably, reach out there. I mean, I'm not sure of institutions or in Indian subcontinent which have at the moment, subjects on visual literacy, because it's become a specialized subject. Okay, so since I said that a lot of visual communication is out of intuition, we have a very strange problem today. Like, we drive on the highway, we get on the flyovers to airport, we see all hoardings around us trying to sell us many things about how dark skinned we are and how fair skinned we need to be, or how probably eating some noodles is good for health because instead of the regular flavors, they have oats or multigrains or whatever. And our basic necessity like water, when it's not easily available, you see water tankers everywhere carrying waters, but there on the water tankers, you will probably have photographs of politicians or statesmen trying to say that they are providing water. Or even the smallest advertisement of roads that come out in newspaper as a big ad, along with the project, there is some symbols of political parties or faces of people. Why? Everybody is trying to communicate with you. Everybody is trying to sell you a product, or trying to sell themselves as leaders for you to vote. So everybody is trying to reach out, and they somehow know the visual communication important, and they've kind of somehow understood probably how to reach you, how to influence you. So we are in an era where images are everywhere, right from notebooks, textbooks, to the hoardings, to television. You just log into your Facebook account, you probably will see your friends' updates, but next to it you'll see advertisements. So everybody is trying to influence you in some or the other way. So it is important for all of us to become responsible citizens and informed consumers that we become visually literate, right? So that is a problem. But what is, I mentioned, that's an image explosion happening around us, but we don't really have a real education on how to look at images. I told you, since the time we are born, it's disregarded that we need to actually study to interpret visuals around us. So that's why there are no formal frameworks to interpret. You probably have frameworks for everything. Probably when you are in school days, maths have always had that you need to have left hand side equal to right hand side as a framework, and you exploit that and get all your wrong calculations from reverse direction, reverse engineering, or something like that. So you have it. So there are frameworks. There are frameworks to see and interpret the world too, which we must all learn. So that is. So if we want to define visual literacy, this is how all textbooks probably define. I had to by heart this answer when I was studying there in Philippines. But in simple terms, what is visual literacy? It's like you're able to see the world, you're able to extract meaning and interpret everything in a context, and then you decide whether you want to believe what that is trying to tell you, or you have doubts, right? Like, for example, how do we react to images? If there's a photograph of people ganging up and beating somebody with sticks, probably you might think, okay, beating is wrong, it's very bad, I dislike what's happening around me. But if there's a caption saying the mob is beating up somebody who's just caught red-handed trying to molest a woman, okay, one half of people say, yes, beat him. Other half of people still say, no, beating is still wrong, whatever it is, the law is there to take his own course. So all of us come in a different context, and all of us interpret visuals in a different context. So visual literacy is the ability to examine, extract meaning, and interpret it in relation with your environment. So that is visual literacy. And when we get into a detailed subject of visual literacy, I'm not going to talk about this, because this is a very big subject by itself. All these things roughly are what they call as tools of visual communication. It's a big subject by itself. Like how, beginning with dots, lines, shapes, and color, how it all affects us. For example, just to give an idea, when you talk of lines in your photographs, when you see lines, like these are lines, right? On the ceiling here, there are lines on the edges there. There are lines around the lapel of your coat. There are lines everywhere. So how probably having straight lines, curved lines, vertical lines, horizontal lines, angular lines, how they all affect how we interpret us, it's all there. There is a lot of truth to it. I will probably, just to give an idea, they say that when you photograph something and the lines probably are not aligned to the vertical or horizontal, if it is diagonals, then they say there's a lot of tension. Our eyes tend to see tension because we are not used to seeing things off balance. We are more comfortable seeing things in balance. Like probably if there is an athlete, he's running straight, it might look calm, but he's about to fall, or a long jump athlete about to dive, his body probably almost in a diagonal, it probably adds tension, it signifies motion. There's a lot of things, even like circles. People say that we as human beings interpret circle with stability or calmness. So every time you see photographs in newspaper of people saying unity is strength, you see an aerial shot of everybody holding hands and forming circle, right? So that's something. And color, have you ever thought why probably the most restaurants or Chinese restaurants in particular have red interiors? Have you ever thought why school buses and institutions are probably colored yellow? Because they say yellow is the strongest color. So when you have color displayed, eyes first tend to go to the color yellow. So for safety for school vehicles, it all started having yellow colored. Red, not red danger in some cultures, No, it say red has that psychological effect of making us more hungry. Hunger. So with culture to culture, things vary. Like there is a particular flower. If you show the photograph of the flower in China, probably it means prosperity. I forgot. But you show the same thing in Japan, it means death. So everything again is in the context, right? So yeah, so red. And they say blue sometimes is not good for your bedrooms, because they say blue has the effect of creating tension, the couples might fight. I'm not sure, but my bedroom is blue, me and my wife haven't fought. Okay. It might work in some cultures. So everything there is a context, right, to interpret things. So this is just an introduction of visual communication, like what these things could have an effect on you. You can probably pick up these details, pursue it, study more on it to improve your own projects. You might be working on your documentaries, even probably in the city or about something, but you can research more and exploit it. But the scope of getting into details of this is, I'm sorry, not really there in this short time. So what I will do is, we will go past visual literacy. I just gave a small introduction to it. I hope I was able to communicate unambiguously what I wanted to on an introduction to visual literacy. And if you have any questions, we'll get back at the end. But that's just a small introduction that please do not ignore visual literacy. It's important. There is a misconception that probably people who are in fine arts or people who are into graphic design, they really need visual literacy. Everybody needs, because we are in an age where we are really influenced by images. So we need to learn that, okay? So yes, so I want to get into language of the image, which is more important. Which is more important probably immediately when you try to photograph somebody, when you probably try to videograph somebody, it's very important. You could take a lot more practical tips from there, okay? But before we get, let's see ourselves in a perspective. Have you seen this chart before?
Yes.
All of you, all of you.
Basic model of communication.
Yes. Yeah, so it's there. So you are the messenger. There's a message, there's a medium, there's an audience, right? So it's quite elementary. So glad we are there so we can proceed further. So yeah, an example of these four elements, somebody, messenger, message, medium, audience. Okay, in visual communication, example of this?
Skype.
Yeah, anything, yeah.
Photograph.
Sorry?
Messenger is a photographer.
Okay.
Photograph.
Yeah.
Medium is a camera. Medium is the camera. Camera. So, audience is a person's voice, seeing the picture.
Okay, so medium is the camera.
Or,
what if I say. Anybody stand up and speak in a first person, it's okay, easier, that's okay, no problem. Okay, let's break it down, simplify it further. I always look at camera as a tool. It's not really a medium. It's probably one of your tools. Like if you're a writer, pen is your tool, camera probably is your tool. You want to record sounds, the recorder is probably a tool. All of it is tool. Photographer, yes. The message is not probably the photograph, but the message is in the photograph, right? But medium could be anything today. I spoke of the word democracy. There's another word called convergence. Have you heard of convergence? So all media is combined together. So probably 15, 20 years back, if I had a photographer, I'm the photographer. Message is my photograph. Medium is the newspaper, which pays me very little. And the audience is somebody who buys the newspaper next day morning. But now it can mean anything. I could be a photographer. The message could be a selfie of me outside Disney World. Medium could be Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, anything. An audience could be all my friends or the people who I don't like but I want to make them jealous. It could be anything. So message there could be to make them jealous. Message could be that. The photograph is there, but message in the photograph. So message is something deeper than just a photograph, right? So, but today, because of convergence, it could be anything. I could be a photographer, I could be a journalist, my message could be a story about, a life of a child in an orphanage, for example, and the medium could be YouTube, and how I package that, I might have videos, I might have sounds, I might have illustrations, I might have photographs, everything together, and the audience. Audience could be anything, the influence makers, probably corporates who I want, probably my idea is to get funding to an NGO. So my audience could be a corporate thing. My audience could be, I want to affect you guys, start thinking about being nice to everybody. The audience could be students, the audience could be anything. So, but when you talk of audience, there is something called as dash audience. Can you fill that blank? Yeah, target audience. So that is very important, because as I said, if you go to China and give that flower to somebody on their somebody's death ceremony, they are not your target audience, they might just throw it back at you. So target audience matters most in visual communication too, right? So that's it. So we know this. We are going to communicate visually to everybody, but do we have a vocabulary to visually communicate, right? So like you're going to start speaking to people, you pick up first food. You want food. You probably tell your parents food. Then you realize your mother is called mom. So you might start saying mom food. Later on you improve your vocabulary. It's like, mom, I want food. Probably learn like something like that. So we build that vocabulary. So as photographers, as videographers, at the heart of everything is a composition. So we are going to talk about that vocabulary. There are 15 elements which probably formally in an educational setting they'll tell. So I'm going to talk about elements. You probably don't have to write detailed notes about it, but note down the element, try to understand that, then go back and experiment with your images or videos, with your mobile phones, selfies, portraits, anything. Experiment with that so that you know that you've taken back something out of this 1 hour post-lunch lecture. You want to sleep, but something you got out of it. So we proceed to the next slide. Yes, so the language of the image. It's a very fancy statement, language of the image. So before we get to the elements, we're going to talk about something called as the photo types, right? So it's quite something called informational, passive, and active. So what is an informational photograph? This is an informational photograph. Two people shaking hands. Does it tell anything else? Where it happened?
It happened. Maybe when he got elected as a prime minister.
-10. Sorry. Okay. So when I went back to the newspaper caption, it said 2013, Chief Minister of Gujarat Narendra Modi visited Delhi and met Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. It dated back. Does it tell about anything? It's just too informational.
They meet each other, unlike the present times.
Could be, but what do you see? They're just shaking hands. Does it tell anything about what event it was? Does it tell anything else about the location? Was it at his house? Was it outside a hotel? Was it a secret political meeting somewhere?
Maybe he's congratulating him.
Something, but it's not clear. It's not evident. You don't really take much out of it, right? So this is like an informational photograph, which probably is just more of a visual record of a person, place, or event. Like in weddings, you have I shoot a lot of weddings and editorial projects and commercial, a lot of it. So weddings, there's a fancy word called candid photography. So I do that a lot. So but in weddings also there's this thing called information photograph, which I don't do, but a lot of people do because a lot of people want it. It's like 1,000 people come for a wedding, everybody comes to greet the couple, they all stand next to the couple and all of them, it's just visual record. It doesn't tell anything whether they like the wedding, whether they dislike the food, they like the food, nothing. It's like whether they're happy that they got married or they dislike the fact that they got nothing. It doesn't say anything beyond that. So it's informational pictures. So informational photographs are more of a record, a place, person, or event. So do you think of any other informational photograph apart from handshake? Anything else?
Photographs of Russian diplomats now in the G20 summit. They have the
yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So you know they are in Australia for the G20.
But it's more like it doesn't really.
Putin was yawning, so he's not interested.
Yeah, but that is more than information photograph. That is probably telling a story. Okay, let's look at a context. Let's imagine. Okay, let's go back to breaking of the Berlin Wall in Germany. Everybody knows the Berlin Wall?
Yes, the wall and the wall.
Okay, so probably the two leaders met there. They signed some treaty. They shook hands and they look at the camera. Pictures there in the newspaper. That's information photograph. But something beyond that, which probably can tell a better story, is the mood, emotion, everything that's happening outside. Probably if you make a you get to the edge of the city and photograph people at the Berlin Wall, probably breaking and trying to reach out to each other, that probably tells you more than just two people signing. They signed, they went back home. But what really happened to Berlin Wall? So you actually get to Berlin Wall to make those images. So those are something we'll get back to later. But this is informational photograph. And one of the most informational, this is very common these days, it's 6 words. Can you tell me what it is? It's seen more on social media. Next picture.
Selfie.
Ah, yes. Selfie, yes. So, selfies also show people. I mean, you probably know, you probably know about Academy Awards. You probably have read it. But if you had never heard of Academy Awards, if you had never heard of Ellen DeGeneres, right? That's her name. Very generous, she is, yeah. So, if you'd probably never heard, so if you probably had never heard of the event, you probably think it's just another selfie, right? Because you've seen in news media, they said the celebrity selfie, and everybody started taking selfies in India, all over. You know there's a story behind it. But if you had never heard of this, you look at it, it's still informational. People smiling, you probably just see the surface, what they wear, what they look like. They look happy, everybody looks good as friends. Probably they don't like each other, but they're posing as friends. This is a visual record, right? So, next comes something as passive photographs, okay? So passive photographs are something which are made of people, places, events with the sole intention of publication or sharing, okay? It's not informational because it's not just a visual record, but it's trying to tell story. When you look at stories, stories have action, events, but passive photograph is made when probably that action or the event of a story is over. You really can't recreate the story. That's when you make passive photograph. So what are passive photographs? And whatever I say is applicable to video too, because it's visual medium, right? I mean, there is a extra element there, it's moving. But composition is the heart of everything. So you can keep these cues for whether you're doing a video work or animation, you can always keep this cues with you, okay? So what are passive photographs? So I explained that they are not informational, they go beyond it. They are made legitimately for environmental portraits, for example. Environmental portraits means you take portraits of people in different environments. Environment does not mean that they're fighting for environmental rights, it's anything. If I make a portrait of you here, it's an environmental portrait of a student, right, in a classroom. So it's all called environmental portrait, right? So so this photograph, it's appeared in a US newspaper called Dallas Morning Star, I think, I'm not sure. But this photograph is from Angola. You heard of Angola, the country? Yeah? So it's a portrait, but it's about one of the children who seen a lot of conflict, and now he's not in that conflict area. He is rescued. He's probably there in a camp, or probably with UNICEF. I'm not really sure. The caption never said that, but he's at a prepared shelter, and behind on the wall you see all his drawings of the memories he has of his hometown, of soldiers killing, tanks, war. So you're not going back to Angola, to warfront, to photograph the child when the war is happening, right? But this is not just informational. It's telling a story. They're talking about his memories. It's a very powerful way to tell a story. Passive photographs are used as a great tool to tell stories of people, right? So there is something which we learn later called personality portraits. Passive photographs are also used in making personality portraits, because portraiture is you bring out something about somebody, their traits, without actually being there at an event. So next, so as I said, for the purpose of public, with a purpose. Passive photographs are obvious. Like you, when you go look at the previous photograph, it is obvious. It's a portrait. You look at this, you know it's a portrait, right? They're getting married, they wanted pictures before that. These days, a lot of people contact me saying they want something called as pre-wedding portraits. Let's go make portraits. So they were not really, I didn't catch them dancing and jumping on the street. It's obvious, right? They post for it, it's obvious, right? So it's again an environmental portrait. It's a passive photograph. right? It's not really their wedding day. It's not like the first time they met, like they show in the movies, right? It's obvious, it's supposed. Photograph again. Next. Ha. So now you know, already know what is active photograph because you went to the next slide and came back. So active photographs are not informational, not passive, because informational photographs just touch the surface. Passive photographs happen when the actual event is over, this action or event is done and you can't recreate it. Active photographs go beyond the surface, unlike informational images, and happen in real time, unlike passive photographs. They happen when the event is going on, and active photographs are what you say in the news media, the voice of publication or voice of an electronic media. If photographer, videographer is not there at a very important event, then the voice of the newspaper is muted, right? Unlike writers, event is over, you get up, make phone calls and talk about the event, you can still get a post-event interview, but you really can't go back. So some of the examples of active photographs. This is after the protests. Not Anna Hazare, Nirbhaya. Okay, so it's see, the thing with active photographs is that you make active photographs to tell a greater story about yourself, your environment, your world, to make your audience happy, sad, or concerned, right? And it's happening real time. So probably this is something that makes you concerned or feel sad about when you see that. But it's all happening real time. So next image, please. This again, long back, Delhi High Court had struck down Section 377, but now it's back. So this was like when it happened, how the members of the LGBT community were celebrating. So if I had arrived late, I probably would have had to make a portrait, right? A passive portrait. But I was there on time and just saw activists really celebrating as they entered this place called, what's it called? There's near Benson Town, I forgot the place name. Okay, so they just had a gathering of all the activists in Bangalore and they were celebrating that. Next. Ha! So we saw previously a photograph which was informational, which was just a selfie. Now there was some other photographer who decided to make an active photograph of the same moment. Right? So there, you know, it was just a selfie of people looking at camera which you could not see. But here there's a photographer who's telling a story, which here is active, people photographing themselves, where there is some setting out there, a lot of people, you know, it's a major event. Now this is an active photograph. Can you go back to that passive photograph? Back. Yeah. So this is passive. Now back. Yeah, this is active. So don't they tell you the difference more clearly than me bringing out words to separate them? Okay, this is all you need to know about the types of photographs or types of visual: informational, passive, and active. You know it very well. Information is rubbish. You really need to look beyond making informational images, right? You probably have to be there to make the active image, but if you are not there, the next best thing is to make passive images, right? So that is it. So we, after having known this, we go to the most important thing, that is to get those vocabulary right, the elements of images, yeah? So there are some 15 elements we'll discuss, which generally cover everything that's there about elements in composition. Yeah, next. Yeah, so this is just a slide which just displays all of it, you know. I mean, you can write it down as in when I discuss about it, so you don't have to write all 15 right now. We'll come slide by slide next. Okay, graphic. So graphic is an element, a vocabulary or element, whatever, just remember that. These are all frameworks, guidelines in making good images and to communicate with others. So graphic is one of the elements of photographs. So what is graphic here? Earlier I spoke about a small slide about visual literacy where I spoke about tools, right? So I mentioned about dots, lines, everything and went all the dimension. So graphic is when you extend those ideas of dots, lines, shapes, forms to create visually pleasing aesthetic images, right? That's where you have graphic in an image. An example would be this. Like you're making, you're exploiting those shapes and forms, the lines, the circles, you're creating something which is aesthetic, right? So it's common to think of graphic by thinking of abstraction. Like the first thing we think of graphic images by looking at abstraction, not like people, but or lines and circles. But you can get graphic images by going beyond just lines and shapes on the walls. You can make graphic images with other aspects too. Next. Like, now these are not lines and shapes, lines, but shape definitely. What are these? Dewdrops on the windshield of a car? Again, they are also graphic, right? They form a symmetry or visually pleasing thing. It probably is not a permanent structure, but it's temporary. I probably woke up on the right time when I was driving to capture this. Again, this is an example of graphic. Now again, this is abstractions, not real things. Lines, shapes and dots. Next image. This is graphic too. This is a wedding, but what is graphic here?
The flowers.
No, the hands. Can you see the hands? So many people. The guy is tying the Mangalsutra to the bride, but everybody is pitched in with their hands. So probably if those hands were not there and him just putting the tali there, it may not be that powerful or that effective. The image is more effective because of mother-in-law, auntie, cousin, sister, best friend, some stranger, all the hands there. Okay, it's not stranger, loved ones. Yeah, flowers are graphic too, but they're not that strongly present there. But these hands are what makes this photograph powerful. Right? Without those hands, it would have been little informational. With the flowers there, makes a little active, but not so powerful. Right? It's an active image. It's an active image. I didn't ask them to pose. It's a real wedding. But active image is more powerful with the element of graphic here. Yeah. So this is not just non-living entity shapes. I'm talking of graphics among people. Like if you're photographing a protest, probably 10 people standing in line could again be graphic, right? If you get to the, if you're shooting rains, you get to your balcony, look down and see some people with umbrellas there. The umbrellas and people walking across make a pattern. They're graphic again, right? So that's it, all you need to know about graphic. Okay, so I hope you understood what graphic. You can just note on the graphic. And now, quality of light. They say photography by definition is painting with light. They say that, right? So there's light, but what is quality of light? Now, quality of light is trying to use either natural ambient light or even artificial light or a combination of both to make your subject strong and contribute to your storytelling, right? What story you're trying to tell. Now, you should be very careful of quality of light. I'll tell you at the end of quality of light why. So we'll see the examples of quality of light, how it can be used with a few images again. Next. Okay, so this is where, what does it tell you? It's probably sunrise, a morning, yeah?
Morning, 7 o'clock, sun
keeps
coming down.
You're the weather person, you know the timing also, 7 o'clock. Okay. So yeah. So it tells you something on morning. Probably if the light was not coming from this window, but had put on the tube light, it would have been just another image of furniture there, right? Probably the element, the strong element in this image, what makes this image, I'll say it's a passive image, okay? Not an active. What makes this passive image good is because of the rays of light, the quality of light, which somehow adds interest, drama here. I should have probably brought the bride and the groom and made them to pose. There would have been a nice picture. I forgot next time. But this was something, you know.
Why would you say this is a passive image and not an active one?
Active in the sense, I'm here like more like a location portrait. It's trying to tell something.
You see, it's morning time.
It's morning time. But for me, it's, you could interpret it that way too, but the way I see it right now, why I am saying it's passive image, it's not informational for me. I'm gone beyond the surface fact, but I'm trying to make a portrait of the place, right? My actual story probably was an event, but I'm trying to make an environmental portrait of the place. Portrait need not always be of people. The way you take the poetic license to interpret what a portrait is, and make a portrait of this place, right? I'm adding light to make it that way. You could, it's open to interpretation. There's nothing called as absolute truth. Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah, thank you. Mobile phone picture, this too. Okay, so I reached Chennai. I was commissioned to shoot a in Chennai. I reached there early. All my cameras, heavy equipment packed in a bag. I saw there, okay, I didn't have to open my bag and fix the camera lens. I just had my, nice. And immediately, I published it to Instagram. And the message was, I have a very good, great morning. I'm in a beautiful place. All you guys, go on your work. So that was it. So yeah, the photographer, the message, you know, the medium was Instagram. And the audience were all the friend circle who I just wanted to make them jealous on a Monday morning. I'm unworking, okay, so yeah. So this is that. So, quality of light. It's not always that light is used to add detail to a subject. Here probably I didn't want, this was in Belur. Belur, near Hasan Chikmagalur, it's a historic. How many of you are from Karnataka here? Probably, they'll know about probably Belur. But it's a historic site, you should probably visit, it's a beautiful place. Weekend you can drive down, you'll reach there in 2 hours, explore, enjoy the archaeology and history. You could go to Halebid, and if you have one more day, you can just go camp in one of the homestays in Chikmagalur, come back the next day, or just come back for Bangalore the same day. So yeah, so quality of light. Light is not always falling on the subject. Right here, there's no detail coming out of it, but it's enhancing its form. You probably know what it is, but it makes this photograph beautiful because the light is coming from behind. It's created something called a silhouette. You understand what silhouette is?
Yes, the
yeah, the shadowy structure. Shadow. Yeah, silhouettes are also a form of storytelling when used in photo series, photo essays. If I had used the auto flash and shot, and it should have become an ugly picture, it probably wouldn't have had that effect. Because of the blue sky and this being dark, it's added something, a very strong contrast, right? If I'd removed the contrast with the fill light, it would have been just another image. So light is not always added to used to make details. It could probably want to make silhouettes. Next. And sometimes the quality of light is the light source itself, right? So if here I've not used the light to add detail to something, or I've not used light to be blocked to create a structure, but I've used the light source itself. The Fuljadi in Diwali, right? You put a slow shutter in your camera and ask somebody to keep doing this, and you get this image right there. So I exploited a camera trick of something called a slow shutter speed, but it's the actual light source itself, right? So you're using light either to add detail or to create silhouettes or add shadows. Somehow you're enhancing the storytelling ability. I mean, she could have just held the full, you know, just this one. But I wanted to show it something more fun. So she went around saying, so tell the story that how she's playing with that cracker there, firework. So this is about quality of light source. We move next. Emotion. This should be very evident to most of us. Emotion in photography, they say, there's a very nice statement, you should buy heart it actually. Emotion in photography is the element which tries to tell the story of human condition. They say human beings, of all creatures on this planet, possess the widest range of emotions, right? So we use emotion to tell stories of human condition. Next, about joy, Next, about sorrow. About sorrow. Or next, about euphoria celebrations. This was Yuvraj Singh in 2007. He scored 100 in Bangalore. And now he's trying to make a comeback. Life changes. So, yeah. So this is an example. Say, you try to capture emotions, right? When people are celebrating festivals, you probably want to capture emotion in their faces. Sometimes weddings, you try to capture that multitude of emotions. Joy, sorrow, confusion, victory, defeat. There are so many things, so many emotions. Something, you can use the word pensive. There are a lot of subtle gradations in emotions. So emotions are a very powerful tool. You should keep that in mind, right? So you don't really have to ask everybody to smile all the time. So next, juxtaposition. This is a very, very, very important tool. Anybody knows what juxtaposition is?
Keeping those, bringing in different elements and combining them. Bringing in two different things or two opposite things.
Yeah, more clear. Two opposite elements. Opposite elements. It's like to present a contrast or irony. Like when you think of the picture of the silhouette, it's light and darkness, right? So that is a juxtaposition too, right? The quality of light, but it has juxtaposition too. Okay, so juxtaposition is that. Next, few examples of juxtaposition. This is dark and white. It's a very strong contrast. The medium is black and white. Yeah, it's from a documentary photography project I did. I followed an adoption of a girl child for a year. I was visiting the family every day, every weekend, to capture how the girl is adopted, how she became part of the family. So I was addressing many issues. One was about gender, because adoption was by a single mother who already had an adopted daughter, going for a second adoption again, daughter. And second issue was about color. The mother was fair skin, the adoptive mother, but the child she was adopting were all dark skin, like me. So it was that bringing out that inherent contrast in the story, the conflict of colors, race, was something which I tried to present. Like very first picture when I made, when the mother was trying to give birth to the baby, it just happened there. It is an active image, not posed. Next. Again, sometimes it's more poetic. Like you see his shirt, it says being human. And when we see blood, we probably tend to something, you know, different cultures have a different interpretation. Probably in some culture, blood is very scary, fear. Then being human, you see the word, it's more of being calm. So in an image, you see that. This is from something called as the Muharram or the Ashura procession, right? Which is observed by the Shia Muslims. Yes, to commemorate the martyrdom of... Yes, so that time. So it's like you captured that. So. It's that. So you're presenting something which is more scary and which is more calm together in a picture. It's not too direct, but when you go through the elements of the story, you get that. The shirt of Mr. Salman Khan's brand and thing. Next, the mood. Mood is the other element. Now, mood in photography is it's something that evokes your the viewer or the reader, the kind of feeling that you get out of a picture. So that is mood. So to understand, let's see some more examples of mood.
The picture of yours was a picture.
Yeah, that also had mood, okay? But here again, the mood of a rainy day, monsoon. It's like somewhere in coming from Khandala, that is, it expresses the mood of, you know, rains or monsoons. Next, chair, mood of solitude. Solitude is the mood too, loneliness. A lot of people, when they are alone at home, they click selfies of the chair, the window. It does present solitude somewhere or the other, if you think in that world. Next. Mood of being playful, playfulness, childhood, you know, carefree mood. It's again mood, right? Next, sense of place. Yes, this is quite important when you're working on projects, documentaries. You talk of subjects, but then you also introduce the place the subject is in, right? Like where the story is set, the country, the city, whatever. So sense of place are elements which tell the reader, which reveal the leader what the place is, the setting of the place. You know, it lets you comprehend those setting. Examples, like if you're familiar with Bangalore, you know where this Tonga is.
UB City,
right? So you know, it's a visual cue. You're the target audience, Bangalorean knows where it is, right? Next picture. Now where would this be? Huh. Though you're not from Sri Lanka, the flag. If I had cropped this picture, it could be anywhere, Mumbai, Delhi, anywhere, or not Delhi, there is no coast in Delhi, Mumbai, anywhere. But because of flag, you have a sense of place, right? So sense of place, you look for the elements when you make images. I want to tell people about a travel story in Sri Lanka, but can I just photograph this horse and this pavement? How do I tell Sri Lanka? I go back. I include something which is very much, you know, strongly saying it's Sri Lanka, it's nowhere else. You don't see this flag in Tamil Nadu anywhere, hoisted. So next. Okay, point of entry in photograph has this element which immediately draws the reader into an image. They form an entry point in the subject. And point of entry, when it's strong, the images tend to become very dramatic. Let me explain with some examples again. Here, it's like a shot with some particular technique called zoom in, zoom out when you shoot photography. So everything else looks motion blurred. But he's right in the center, he's sharp. It's like a point of entry into the picture, right? So usually there are a lot of portraits in environments, human faces tend to be naturally the strong point of entry. Next, here, the eyes are like the strong point of entry. When you look at that, first thing you'll see probably are eyes, right? In generally not always, in black and white photographs or portraits, the white areas around your iris become the entry points. Sometimes the entry points are specific area points, or sometimes like general areas. Okay, and the next picture, here again, everything is out of focus. Just this crocodile's jaws opening is a strong entry point. So you look for the entry points in your images too when you make. You avoid clutter. So that's it about point of entry. Next, rule of thirds. I think this most people know. But rule of third is actually something which is carried on from this Renaissance and classical paintings, that you tend to look at images as visual thirds. Like it's exploits our eyes because we naturally interpret images in thirds. Examples, 1, 2, 3, three couples. We interpret images again as thirds. Next, 1, 2, 3. That's what makes the image interesting. The thirds, when you find three elements. Next, 1, this wall 2, this wall 3. You've broken this image into three. I mean, it has other elements too, like lights, graphics, everything. But rule of third is very evident. You've broken the image into visual thirds. So when you're looking for this composition, do that. Generally in photography, people think rule of thirds is like when you draw two lines like this and two lines, the point of intersections, right? When you have an interesting subject there, that is rule of thirds. That also makes it visually appealing. But actually, rule of thirds is this, when you can divide an image into three areas, distinct area, that's rule of thirds. So next, visual perspective. Yes, so visual perspective is that you as photographers are the eyes for the readers. The reader cannot travel there, so you're trying to present in images something unique, your own visual perspective, which is not really obvious, but only because of you it becomes evident to the reader. For example, doing an aerial photography, right? Or probably you get underwater or at the edge of water where you can see land and water both, something like that. Let's look at some examples quickly. It's a beach, but you could probably have shot there the camel walking on the sand, but you go on top of the lighthouse, Kapu Lighthouse, this is in South Canada, Kapu, and you go on top of the lighthouse, you shoot, you get a different perspective there, right? The whole photograph of probably you want to tell a story of the camel and the beach in South Canberra. You could have shot it down there, but you want to do something else. So you climb up the lighthouse and shoot this image. Tell a different perspective altogether. Next, again, it's a wedding, but the usual pictures are there in the album of, you know, you're there, but then you suddenly see, okay, let me go up and present an aerial perspective again. It presents something else, a unique view probably of the to the viewer. They probably can comprehend how big probably was the mantap, something which is not obvious otherwise in two-dimensional images when you shoot, you know, with of in a range where you're shooting the face. Okay, next. Again, somebody wanted to make photographs of, say, if I had to make some photograph of Bombay's skyscraper, I could have just shot this skyscraper alone. This is in Dadar in Bombay. But I wanted to show probably what is around the skyscraper, how it is, you know, grown within the city. So there's parts of Dadar which are old here, and there's that huge skyscraper coming up there. So different perspective again. It's as a photographer, my perspective. So as photographers, as videographers, you try to bring out your own perspective. The perspective, your perspective is an element. Remember that. It probably is not evident in those graphics or not, but your perspective, the way you think, that is very important. Next. Now we talk of visual perspective. Now something called visual surprise. Surprise, something which is unexpected, rather than bringing your own perspective. It's something which really surprises the viewer. Oh, I never thought this can happen. Okay, so it's usually usually the images with visual surprise, images with humor. So let's see some example. So I was photographing her in again Bombay in Bandra, I think, Bandstand in Bombay, on rain. I was photographing her, suddenly the wind blew and the umbrella was about to go there. That's a surprise, right? It's unexpected. You sometimes have lucky. You can't really plan for it. But when something happens, you anticipate and you make it. A lot of things that goes into making visually surprising images are like being at the right place at the right time. That's there, luck is there. But then, next picture. Surprise again. There's humor, right? Humor is a visual surprise. Humor is always surprise. Joke is always surprise. Something is always surprise. So you're photographing there, suddenly you see something happening. You do it. It's like, it's not luck. You see it happening and you photograph. Okay? But sometimes there's a lot of luck involved. Like next photograph. Unexpected. The photographer, I don't know, I forgot his name. But he was photographing the athlete who's fallen down. But while he was photographing, he never expected it. Other athlete came and stamped her leg. Unexpected. You don't think of a normal course. So here he was purely luck, being at right place, right time. Credit to the photographer, he was not lazy. Why should I shoot the photographer falling? Let me go shoot the photographer who's winning. He decided to pursue the subject he wanted, and luck favored him. Next. Layering is another important element in photo storytelling. Layering is you know, you're trying to use very dominant foreground, main entry point to your story, and then having lot of other element trying to tell other stories. It's like having lot of elements in foreground, background, layers, right? You understand? It's not just having one interesting thing. So usually there is a dominant foreground and lesser dominant background for different elements, or reverse. So example, there's a lot of layering. It rains. So there is, the focus is somewhere here of this guy who's sitting there in his scooter with umbrella. But there is a layer of a taxi coming. There's a layer of one more guy in different plane altogether walking with an umbrella. It's a lot of things happening. Next, layers again here. Like there are kids using mobile phones, some uncle stretching out, one more uncle there reaching out with his hands there. And this camel coming here, this cup coming here. This is in Malpe, in South Canada, Malpe Beach in Udupi. Okay, so next. This is again Bangalore on Eid. So many things happening. This uncle is rushing to the mosque. This uncle is trying to put on his cap. There are people wishing each other. And there are barricades suddenly put by the traffic police to control the movement of traffic. A lot of things happening. It's about festival, but there are a lot of layers. So you're looking multiple points of interest in a picture. That's layering. Next. Moment. Have you ever heard of Henri Cartier-Bresson? Have you heard of Henri Cartier-Bresson? Or have you heard of decisive moment? Okay, Henri Cartier is spelled Henri, H-E-N-R-I. Cartier is C-A-R-T-I-E-R. Bresson is B-R-E-S-S-O-N. Henri Cartier-Bresson is a legendary photographer, one of the founders of Magnum, and he coined the term decisive moment. So what I'm talking about moment in photography is same as decisive moment in a way. You can go back and research on Bresson and decisive moment. It's used a lot in street photography. So moment in photography is that there is a particular moment, and if you are able to photograph that time, you probably capture the truth properly. And if you miss that moment, your image quality degrades. And as a photographer, if you miss that moment is lost forever. You really can't recreate. But that is something which you call a decisive moment when Bresson talks about it. So example of, you know, capturing the right moment, right time is this. Like cricket, short leg bounce, and he's just caught the ball. You know, just little more, 1 second here and there, probably would have thrown the ball up with celebration, I would have missed that moment. Next. This is a Tiger cub which is just yawned. At the right time, you know, like just try to make a baby groan. Just then. If I missed that, I would have lost the quality of picture. It would have been just a normal portrait, or the face would have been the other side. It's that I got that right moment. So a lot of time this is in active photographs where there's sports happening, sports, or there's a lot of movement happening, there's a lot of activity. That's when you anticipate. A lot of this idea goes into making good street photographs. Street photography, the heart of street photography is there in decisive moments. Next. Again, this was at a party in Bangalore, it's a media event it was, and she was about to clap. I see that she's not clapped. There is that gap, that moment, fraction, when it's not in contact. And that's make it more dynamic. If the hand had joined together, it probably would have lost its form factor, right? So yeah, next. Yeah, so we're talking of passive images. This is the last one, the last element. It's called the personality portrait. So what is personality portrait? Personality portraits are passive images, but they're not just environmental portraits. You see personality portrait in relation to storytelling. You're trying, okay, I'm standing here and you photograph me, it probably doesn't tell much about who I am, what I do. Probably it shows me an environment. Personality portrait probably would be like where you're making an image of me trying to tell that I'm probably a photographer. I'm a visual storyteller or I'm a teacher or something. Examples, next. This is Sharad Gaikwad. He's a Paralympic swimmer. He's the first Indian to qualify for Paralympics. So I had to make an environmental portrait of his. He had won the bronze medal in Guangzhou Para-Asian Games. So he's a swimmer. You know by this, he's a swimmer. He's probably a medalist. He's at his pool. He's his environment. This is an example of personality portrait. Next. She is the first transgender radio jockey in India. She's a radio jockey with community radio in Bangalore, CR Radio 90.4, I think. So you look at it, you know she's a radio station, you know she's a radio jockey. It's again an example of personality portrait, right? Self-portrait, last. Personality portrait of a photographer, a selfie. I'm at an event, I know something happening, and then I photograph myself. This is my portrait, self-portrait.